used to
Hey, everybody. Everyone, hello. Welcome to Ready to Ramble! Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Ready to Ramble, the wrestling discussion show here on Hyper RPG, where me, Cameron Rice, this lady here on my left, introduce yourself.
I'm Sarah the Rebel.
And we have a guest, Sarah, who is with us today.
Kyle.
Hi, I'm Kyle. I'm a voice actor. Hey, everybody. I'm a wrestling fan, too.
It's like, why is that Dragon Ball Z guy on a wrestling show? Because reasons!
That's all you need.
I don't see a confusion at all. I feel like every Dragon Ball Z fan is also a wrestling fan.
It's perfect idea. Yes, the perfect melding. Yes, I'm all for it.
We'll test that. We'll have to bring Danny in at some point and be like, who's your favorite? She'll be like, I don't know.
Yeah, I bet you would be surprised. I know her favorite is.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, don't tell me.
Okay.
We'll be surprised. As you're noticing, we're missing somebody. Who, to be fair, you...
No, I'm going to call him out right
now. Do it. Call him out.
Iffy, this is about you. You think you can treat us this way? Iffy, I saw a picture, right? I'm like, where's my man Ziffy at? Oh, he's at GDC. That's cool. Guess he'll be back in time for the show. I'm going to like this picture. Then, Iffy, my man's, my friend, why are you not commenting in the agenda or giving any information that I need? Oh, what's that? You're not going to be on the show today? Then, today I get a phone call. Hey, Sarah, just found out Iffy's not going to be able to be on Krillin It. Can you be the co-host? Iffy, I'm calling you out right now. I want a match next Monday night on Raw. Or what? Our show, Ready to Ramble.
What are you going to do to him in the ring?
I'm going to suplex that hoe.
Oh, man.
There it is.
It just got real.
So, guys, it's going to be interesting because Iffy had the homework assignment. So those of you who watch the homework assignment, you're lucky. It's like when your teacher gives you a test, you come into school the next day, and she's sick.
Yep.
You're not going to get that test. So we're going to talk about that homework assignment next week. You're going to get two homework assignments for next week. We're going to deep dive into those. But we'll get to that later. Guys, if you're joining us for the first time, this is a wrestling discussion show. We talk about news in the wrestling world, things that are happening. We predict pay-per-views because there's a pay-per-view tomorrow. Fastlane. It's a Raw pay-per-view. And we dive into some other little things, matches of the week, what's going on in the shows, what we like, what we don't like. But also, if you're watching this and you're not a wrestling fan, please stick around. We try to make the show very accessible for those who are not too into the tights and fights crowd.
But you should be.
That's a different podcast, though, and that's you should listen to that one, too, actually.
Shout out to Tights and Fights.
Shout out to Tights and Fights. But, guys, let's get to know our guest.
Yes.
Let us get to know our guest.
Oh, my.
So, what got you in to sports entertainment?
Well, let's see. As a youngin' back in the day, in the 70s, because, God, I'm old. But anyway,
good time to be a fan, though.
Yeah, exactly. I'm from Dallas originally, and I grew up watching the Von Erichs.
Oh, so those of you watching, the Von Erichs, was it CPW? Was that what was?
Oh my God, I didn't even know any of those terminologies.
World class championship wrestling, I believe.
There you go. Yeah,
they often fought in the Sportatorium. Is it the
Sportatorium?
Sportatorium. For those of you who are wrestling fans, you might hear the Sportatorium a lot. Mentioned by Stone Cold Steve Austin. That's where he went and saw wrestling. He grew up in the similar area.
Mm-hmm.
Also a big fan of the Von Erichs. There's a great documentary put out by WWE called I think it's called the True and Tragic Story of that organization, and it's mostly about the Von Erichs. 30 for 30 did a Von Erich special. Go seek those things out. But anyway.
Ooh, that sounds like my homework assignment.
Oh.
That would take me back. I mean, Saturday Night Wrestling, man. And you knew you had to tune in for it because otherwise it would turn to like Porter Wagner and Dolly Parton or something. It just turned to like, or Lawrence Welk. It's like, where's wrestling, man? I want to watch.
I watched Lawrence Welk a lot as a child.
All the bubbles. Yes, all the bubbles.
Do you remember your first match? Like, what you maybe come across on TV? Or?
Oh, God, no. I don't remember the actual first match. I just remember the Von Erichs leaving such an impression. Skandar Akbar, some of those big ones at the time in Dallas. Kabuki. He had this whole thing with spraying the mist and stuff.
The green. Do you want to explain the green mist? Sarah?
I've never understood the Green Mist.
You never understood the Green Mist?
do you actually know what's going on there? Because I don't.
The Green Mist seems to be something that a lot of Japanese wrestlers, when they come over here, do. Tajiri.
Tajiri does it now, yep.
There's a lot of female wrestlers who do it. I don't understand the significance of it. That's probably something we... That's my homework assignment. Let me find out what the Green
New
Mist
homework. Let's
truly
take that.
Is.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's all homework all the time. But did you ever get to see the Fabulous Freebirds?
Only on TV. I never actually went in person to see any matches because, I didn't know how much. It probably cost too much, and my parents would have said, no.
That's what happened to me. So I know back in the day you used to watch, and then like a lot of wrestling fans, kind of fell off for a while, and right. I think all of us do. So what got you back into wrestling again?
It's funny because of what you're wearing on your head, representative of the great and awesome New Day.
Power positivity.
So last April, right, on WrestleMania, mm-hmm. A lot of my voice acting cohorts are wrestling fans, and they're all commenting on everything, and they're posting screenshots of New Day coming out as insane warriors in their garb. And I'm like, oh my God, I can't believe this. Maybe I have to like tune in and check out this wrestling thing again, because so many of my friends and colleagues are into this. Mm. And I've been out of it for decades. You know, when I was starting to fall out of it, I was in high school and you had Hulk. And you had Macho Man and all that stuff back in their heyday. And I missed the whole Attitude Era.
Wow. So you left during the superhero era.
I missed it all, man. I wish I could go back. And, of course, now I'm a WWE subscriber.
Oh, you can go back.
And I can go back. Yeah. And I meant to actually do the homework from last week. And I totally...
Don't worry. Neither did the guy who assigned it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's all good. The teacher has said, never mind, next week.
He had to go to Comic-Con.
But I got to say that WrestleMania last year it was exciting because I saw the ladies take participation too, mm-hmm. and that to me who's been out of it for a long time, I thought they were specifically separated, segregated, and everything. And then I didn't know that. I mean, I'm sure it's been that way for a long time, but as a fan, I was like, this is really cool. It's the way it should have been from the beginning,
right?
And I like that, like seeing the mixture of everything. And I got really excited by the Undertaker match in the with Shane in the cell. That was
What a thing.
That was a thing to behold.
Yeah. What a leap.
Some
people are telling us in the chat what some of the different mists mean. Red mist burns and blue mist sends you to sleep.
I was wondering if green is poison. So Sarah is not scratching her, you know what? I just got a bunch of pink frosting on my leg and now it's on my pants. So that's going to leave a mark. It was somebody's birthday on the last show that I was just on.
We took their cake.
And we took their cake. That's your half, by the way.
Sweet 3D'd cup and cakes.
Yeah. We 3D'd them through a table.
Yes. It's funfetti, so, it's really fun.
You had to have it. So who do you like right now besides New Day?
Oh, God. It's a long list, man. I like Seth Rollins, who I hope we'll see.
Oh, we're going to be talking. We'll be talking about that.
Okay,
in the news of the week.
Good.
Oh, yeah.
I love Undertaker just because, man, that guy's a beast. And he doesn't have to show up but maybe once a year. And everyone's just like, I bow before you. I'm not worthy.
And let me ask you that. Have you been to a live show yet?
I have. I've been to a couple of Raws in the last year. Exciting stuff. I haven't seen any SmackDown yet because of the wonky world of voice acting. I get a session at the last second and they're like, okay, I guess I won't go this time.
But, which many people feel is the superior show.
I've heard that.
Yes.
I've heard that. Yeah. Yeah. And, the list continues, man. I love Jericho, Owens, Dean Ambrose.
Kyle Owens posted a picture. I don't know if it was today or if I just saw it today. And he was like, basically, if I can beat a 9-year-old at Mario Kart like this, then I could definitely beat Goldberg. And it's a picture of him holding the controller and he's got a cat on his chest and a dog in his lap. He just like looks like a comfy dad. And I was like, oh, I was mad at you after the Jericho thing, but now I'm back to being in love with you because you're adorable.
Nice. I would say if you are a fan or not a fan, Kevin Owens is truly one of the funniest like tweeters. Mm-hmm. And he also, his son kind of went viral because when Kevin Owens debuted on Raw, his son's favorite wrestler was John Cena. And at the time, John Cena was doing, he was the U.S. champion, and he was doing something called the John Cena Open Challenge, where anybody who wanted to come out and challenge him could challenge him. So Kevin Owens' wife was filming their son, and John Cena's on TV saying, anybody who wants to take the challenge, come take the challenge. Kevin Owens' music hits, and his son goes, he's going to fight John Cena! and at this point, Cena was going through everybody winning those challenges, and Owens beat Cena. Mm-hmm. Like, he took him out and then faced him in a match and beat him clean, which was not something that Cena was usually doing. So I recommend on following Owen's on Twitter, very funny, has no issue calling out fans.
And I also recommend, again, like I mentioned that one time, go find videos of kids watching John Cena lose. It's so good.
It's the modern day reaction video.
Yes, just tears, lots of tears.
It's the child's version of the two girl one cup.
Yes,
video.
Yes. There, it's like you're catching their reaction of just you're watching their dreams crumble. Superman just lost to them.
Yeah, I gotta ask. It's funny you mentioned Superman. When I saw Roman Reigns, I thought, oh, he's good and everything. And then little Karibo, you know, from Yu-Gi-Oh, Abridged, talks like, no, Kyle, you're doing it wrong. It's like, oh, then I hear from people. It's like, no, they're shoving Roman Reigns down everyone's throats, and that's why nobody on the whole tends to like the guy.
You are allowed to like Roman Reigns. Follow your instincts.
Follow your instincts, right?
That's why I say a lot of people, you know, we wrestling fans sometimes we can be really tough on each other.
Yes.
And like, oh, you don't think that this wrestler is the greatest wrestler of all time? Well, you don't know wrestling, or oh, you like this person? You're a mark. Like, it's bullshit. Don't listen to anyone who says that to you. And if you're one of the people who say that, Sarah says stop saying that right now. I couldn't see my fingers. I'm gonna point with this finger. I say stop it because. Let people enjoy and love. And yeah, if you're doing ribbon or it's a light joke, cool. But like, don't make somebody feel bad for liking a wrestler. There's a reason there's so many different wrestlers. It's because there's somebody for everyone. Some of us like unicorns.
True. Unless you're a fan of the Great Khali.
And then you don't.
Then we're going to have
some
words.
Some of us like Glamazons.
We're going to have
you guys
so many
can't
words.
See my normal arm that does things is off camera right now.
Oh.
Got to flex with this arm. It's fine.
Oh, you're going to have to make it work, girl. Make it work.
And let me give a quick shout out to some of the lady wrestlers. Sasha Banks.
Oh, Sasha's great.
And Bayley.
You don't
I
have
love
to move
two.
It because of me. I'm sorry. I was just joking.
Louis C. Luke is just coming around. He's like, oh, she wants to show her guns. I'm so sorry.
Kyle scooted more. That just would have never happened.
All right, I'll do that. Don't worry. It's not like he doesn't have cooties. I'm all good. It's all right.
I do.
So are you? I'm fine with that.
That's a little cake.
So are you a weekly watcher?
I am a weekly watcher, except for this week. I got caught up in other
no
things.
No worries.
So I'm going to listen very intently during the news segment, though, because I missed who all is the winner this week.
Well, the big thing, you mentioned him already, Seth Rollins came out, and it looked like it was announced, like, got onto the dirt sheets Sunday night, the night before. Seth Rollins, big announcement on Raw, and we're all sitting here going, oh, God. Because at this point, with Daniel Bryan, Edge, all these other wrestlers, we've been trained. If we hear the words, big announcement on Raw, it's not good news. And Seth Rollins already had to sit out last year's Mania.
Yeah.
So we thought this was going to be him saying, like, I'm out again. Oh, God, I'm out.
And just to rewind slightly, for those watching who don't watch wrestling, Seth Rollins is somebody who came up very quickly, did a lot of really cool things.
Yes.
And then surprising and shockingly was injured and not able to be in WrestleMania, like Cameron said. So it was kind of a big deal that happened. And then he came back and his whole thing was being renewed and rejuvenated and rebuilt and better than ever before.
I'm Seth freaking Rollins! Seth freaking Rollins!
I'll tell you something that endeared me to him was that documentary.
The documentary is great.
That really sucked me in. It's like, man, this guy, I'm behind him.
So he comes out and he's blaming himself. A friend of mine, Dan Black, who's a comedian that hosts a great podcast called The Comedians of Wrestling, talked about like how many times he kept saying dude.
Yeah, that was really
my fault, dude.
I was like, oh, I hate this. I know you're just trying to seem like a man of the people right now, but you're coming off as like, ugh.
Drop so many dudes. But then out comes Triple H and they start like going back and forth. And Seth Rollins got fired up, and he's like, I'll be at WrestleMania!
Yes.
So we're going to see. That doesn't necessarily mean a match is going to take place.
Mm-hmm.
But there might be a Triple H match, and it wouldn't be shocking if Rollins interferes.
Right. It does seem like he probably won't be medically cleared. So,
yes.
But the fact that he's, you know, they turned it around, I thought that was... Although it's always slightly boring when people are just talking instead of wrestling. But sure. I did think that this was some good storytelling because they did that arc of like, oh, victim blame, it's my own fault, and I don't know if I'm going to make it. And then, ha ha ha, you won't ever make it. I'm the villain. And then the hero was like, never mind. I found my sword of confidence.
Yeah. And it was this storyline's been a little rough, if only because, like, so for those who don't know, Seth Rollins, when he came back, he was going for the championship because he lost, because he didn't officially lose the championship. He got injured and he had to give it up. So they had a fatal four-way. Triple H was his guy. He was Triple H's guy. Mm-hmm. So they're having this fatal four-way. Triple H interferes and it looks like, oh, he's going to help Seth Rollins. And instead he hurts Seth Rollins and gives the belt to Kevin Owens. So Seth Rollins, you would think then the hunt is, oh, I'm going to go after Triple H. And that's kind of been the hunt. But they've also kind of kept Seth Rollins on ice for 4 or 5 months. So Triple H was doing NXT work.
Right. So it was like many months. I don't even know how many of this not happening, but the commenters kind of mentioning that it was going to happen. So it really took a lot of the steam out of what should have been a storyline. I'd almost forgotten about that four-way match.
Yeah. And then the sad ironies of sad ironies, they finally start building that storyline up again, and Seth Rollins got for real injured.
Just really, really sucks.
But at least it's not as severe. You know, he should be able to bounce back a lot quicker than a year, you know?
Yeah, exactly. But yeah, watch that documentary. It's really great. Other than that, the other big thing on Raw, this one we do have a photo of. Let me pull it up. Yep. God, we love these guys so much.
They're
they're
normally so funny. If anyone watching doesn't know, this unicorn horn that I'm wearing is part of their merchandise.
So, Lucas is grabbing firewood, so he can't jump to the photo yet. It's a New Day. We're talking about the New Day. Lucas!
Lucas is grabbing firewood.
Their cereal's not half bad, by the way.
Are we?
I bought a box of Booty O's.
Yeah, I liked it. It just tastes like Lucky Charms, but slightly less than Lucky Charms. So this was a joke where they said they were about to have a match with the Shining Stars. Then somebody came out, like a producer, and Xavier pretended to argue with him, and then he took the sheet of paper and said, Shining Stars, so sorry. You actually have a match with the Big Show later. We have a match with Rusev, sorry. Now, this was clearly a joke about the Oscars.
Yeah.
But WWE's the crowd had no reaction.
Yeah, WWE's, this felt like a written thing for them. The great thing about the New Day is it feels like they're very improvisational. Like, they kind of maybe get, like, bullet points of, like, hit this, go for it. This, whenever WWE is scripted humor, a little rough.
Well, Big E even said, when he was like, we're going to take the shine off your stars or something like that, he said, I didn't write that. Like, he actually says that really quick under his breath. So I agree with you. I think they wrote that for them and that they knew this ain't really going to fly, but we're just going to do our best. Because what it did is it took the wind out of something that could have been really awesome, which is, oh my God, the Shining Stars have to fight Big Show. They're going to die. Like, that should have been a moment.
Yep,
and
I
instead
agree.
It was just blue.
So someone's asking if we can explain booty-os. They don't actually understand the concept. So, I'll let you take that one.
Well, that's what, they first come out last WrestleMania in a giant box of booty-os, a little parody cereal thing. And it actually is a cereal. They've marketed it. Yep. You can get it through FYE, I think. And,
you can buy that cereal. So there, the whole idea behind the New Day, I'll give you a little New Day brief history lesson. Basically, the New Day came together and they pitched themselves as, hey, we want to be all about positivity and blah, blah, blah.
Yes.
Well, that wasn't quite understood the way they intended it. And they were told, okay, so your gimmick is you're going to be preachers. So the New Day were preachers. It was a pretty racist kind of thing to do.
They still have that music.
That's
why their music is
that's why they have the whoa, whoa, whoa. Yes. That's from a gospel choir. So anyway, long story short, they end up turning the crowd hated them. They ended up turning it around and then became popular enough to go with the actual gimmick that they wanted, which was about the power of positivity. So they're all about rainbows. They're about unicorns. They're about all these happy-go-lucky things. And they like to say things like, make sure you ain't booty or you booty or blah, blah, blah. So the joke became that you buy these booty-os, they make sure you ain't booty. And in case you don't understand slang, booty would in this instance mean bad, that you suck. So you don't ever want to be booty.
Yeah.
But you do want booty juice in your ice cream. We can talk about that some other time.
I wish Ify was here to talk about that booty juice.
He probably has a whole story about booty juice.
Oh, I'm sure.
God.
So those were that was the big thing on Raw. This was the go home Raw, and it didn't feel, because like we have Fastlane for tomorrow. There's a Raw pay per view. Not the best go home Raw show.
Yeah, I had a hard time watching this week. I'm not gonna lie.
Kind of dull. I think a big part of it is like mostly creative at this point is gearing up for WrestleMania. SmackDown does not have another pay per view until Mania. Like that's their thing. There is a degree of. This just feels like a pay-per-view that doesn't matter. Like, it's a placeholder.
Yeah, they've done nothing to get me excited about Fastlane. I mean,
Other than Kevin Owens Goldberg.
Kevin Owens and Goldberg,
that's the
only thing where it's like, we've never seen this before. Everything else is like, we've seen these matches, and
we see them on Raw for free, and constantly.
Right, and there's no new, stakes have not been raised.
Correct.
For any of them.
So, question, you said Goldberg. Goldberg is scheduled tomorrow in Fastlane?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, he's
is that
fighting,
tomorrow?
He's fighting Kevin Owens for the Universal Championship. And there was also a rumor today, if you want to avoid, I won't spoil it, but Amazon Release the DVD cover for this pay-per-view, and there's some spoilers on there.
Great job, Amazon.
Wow.
So that made the dirt sheets about, like, it's like Fastlane, and you see, like, you see Goldberg, and then you see some other faces who I think were supposed to be surprise interferences.
Amazon, this was supposed to be a surprise.
So, yeah, I was like, good job, Amazon. Oh, but also, bad job, WWE, for giving them the cover.
Yeah.
So early, but that happens.
So if you want to see, go look that up.
Yeah, if you want to avoid spoilers.
Oh, before we get into Fastlane, though, I do just want to, can we touch on Jack Swagger, or did you want to leave that for later on?
No, we can touch on, we can go SmackDown real quick, and then we'll touch on
okay.
Swagger. SmackDown, the big things on SmackDown, we're still, we're kind of, it's a better show, but we're getting a little placeholdery or building up what are going to be eventual Mania storylines. The big thing, though, is Randy Orton burnt down.
Yes.
The Wyatt compound.
Oh, okay. This history story going to be good. All right. So.
Dive into it, Sarah.
The Wyatt, it's going to be a much shorter version because the Wyatt family can be complicated at times. But basically, the Wyatt family is run by this guy named Bray Wyatt. I wasn't calling him gay. He's just Bray. And I said guy. Okay. Anyway, listen. He's like a cult leader. This is a cult, and they wear like sheep masks, and they have their little fireflies. When they turn the lights down, when they come, everyone puts their phones on. It's really cool and creepy. I love their gimmick. So the idea is that Bray Wyatt hears Sister Abigail, this like maybe ghost in his head, somebody who died.
Supposed to be his like literal sister, supposedly. How they haven't, the man's been around for like 4 or 5 years now. How they have not had a female wrestler play Sister Abigail yet?
Yeah, people bring it up all the time. They're like, you know how cool it would be if you just did it, but they never do it. So anyway, he has a compound, which is not at the WWE. It's like in the woods somewhere. The New Day once went there and had a really hilarious fight. Now, it wasn't supposed to be hilarious, but it was hilarious nonetheless. It involved mud and everything. So anywho, Bray Wyatt and Randy Orton have been teaming up lately. Basically, Bray Wyatt beat Randy Orton up so bad that eventually his mind cracked and he joined the Wyatt family, supposedly. But now it turns out maybe that was not the case.
No.
And so Randy Orton...
Randy Orton was already crazy.
Yes.
I have voices in my head that talk to me.
Anyway. Sorry, everybody.
We didn't plan that. It just went well.
But it went really well. So Randy Orton has done this ultimate betrayal, and he has burned the compound and the ghost of Sister Abigail down.
Yeah.
And then he did his pose in the fire.
Ooh.
Yeah. Although the cameraman should have posed it a little better, that the flames were in the middle of Randy Orton. The way the camera was posed, they were kind of like right off on the side of Randy Orton. They didn't pose it quite as well as it could have been. Could have been a cool little dramatic moment that Randy Orton puts in like an eventual retirement reel. I ruined it.
Yeah. PWJB, I would just say, I think for both of us and for a lot of people's opinion, it's not that Sister Abigail, her actual self, shows up, but that a female wrestler is possessed with the spirit of Sister Abigail, and that person is Sister Abigail.
Something like that. I mean, The Undertaker's an undead wizard, so we're still going with that.
I always feel like the Wyatts, so much more could be done, and their angle with the New Day was the closest that I had seen to them actually making the cool, creepy, scary magic happen again that we had with Undertaker, and then they were like, haha, brand split.
See, when I heard, you know, when you see Bray he's doing the Sister Abigail, it's like, is that named after a really violent nun that he grew
that's
up
what
in
I thought
Catholic
at first
school
too.
Or something like that?
Oh, man, that would have been
like, you
amazing.
Know, the nun who used to put people into terrible positions.
Yeah.
Yeah, not the ones that take the ruler and just whack you on the knuckles. No, this one totally.
And he usually kisses the person on the forehead before he does it, which just adds it.
Like,
it's
tender,
such
very
a
tender.
Great gimmick. I love it. And they could push it further.
But there's something some people mentioned in the chat. We're going to talk about him, too. I think a lot of that great Bray Wyatt stuff that's filmed off of not at the WWE arena, wherever they're filming, a lot of that's owed to Matt Hardy, man. Matt Hardy's doing Final Deletion and all that kind of stuff. Soon enough, you saw WWE start doing like, well, we should maybe go film stuff like little movies.
Yeah.
So it's great. I'm actually looking forward to a Randy Orton match at WrestleMania. I don't know what happened. I don't know what happened, everyone.
Yeah.
But I'm actually looking forward to it. And then they're building up AJ versus Shane, which, God, what a misuse of AJ Styles. The man's had a hell of a year.
Yeah.
He should be a big time. He should have a big time match at Mania.
I forgot to mention him, but yeah, absolutely.
Oh, AJ's so good.
He's one of the best. I'd say him and Cesaro right now are probably the top two performers in WWE.
Oh,
I agree.
And he had so much potential. He came in so hot, and then they've kind of let him fall as they've tried to tell other people's stories, which is something that happens when you have a big roster. But to then be like, here's this guy who's not really a wrestler, and there's no real reason for this to happen, but we're going to have AJ fight him. But yeah. Why?
And someone just brought up, why can't they call up Nakamura and have him fight AJ? I would love that.
Ooh. There's a lot they could do. If they would let go of this brand split being so strong. Mm-hmm. Like, again, why is WrestleMania only having matches between, still within the brands?
They are, so far.
Like, that's really weird to me that they, WrestleMania should be all bets are off. You can wrestle whoever.
Right.
And this will be a chance to have something cool like AJ versus, I don't know, Roman or somebody. Like, I don't really want him to go against Roman. But, you know, they could be more creative with it. And instead, right, they're kind of locked in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I mean, and I have no qualms with Shane McMahon, but he's definitely, there's something of a degree of like, it just feels like a misuse of AJ.
Man can't even take a spear. I'm just kidding. Don't hurt me, Shane.
Oh, yeah. For those of you who don't know, Shane McMahon did a jump off the top rope and got speared by Roman Reigns and definitely looked like he got concussed.
Yeah, he looked concussed. Absolutely. As someone who's been concussed.
That's a great word.
Yeah. He looked concussed. He was concussed.
PWJB. I hear what you're saying about, yeah, WWE's track record with Japanese wrestlers, but I'd say actually over the last 2 years, it's been pretty good. They just haven't called up any yet from NXT because Asuka's down there.
Yeah.
And she's killing it. Mm-hmm.
And in the cruiserweights, we got some cool stuff going on. I think it just depends. I think they are often swayed by the public. You know, for example, you know, different, you know, Middle Eastern in this case, but, you know, changing how they portray certain wrestlers based on their race and mm-hmm. things like that. They are more cognizant of that now than before. So I think it's something that they could do well. And NXT is doing a great job.
I agree. So that's what happened on the TV show. Did I miss any major? I mean, there's the other storylines, obviously, but I think like these were both all kind of...
Yeah,
I don't know if I'm missing anything major.
For the sake of having enough time for the Q&A at the end, I'm going to say, yep, that was all that happened. Moving on.
So that was the on-camera storyline stuff. Guys, let's talk about behind the scenes.
Ooh.
So Jack Swagger has joined the list of has joined the list of superstars who have turned in their request to be let go from the WWE.
Correct.
They were doing contract negotiations. He joins a proud line of Ryback, CM Punk. Well, CM Punk was on a contract dispute. But
essentially, he felt that he could be paid more wrestling for other places than wrestling for the WWE. And since we haven't really seen him on TV this whole time, I'm going to have to say he's probably correct.
Yeah, so Swagger's an interesting guy. Swagger's very, like, what's he, like 6'5", 6'6"? Now, yeah. It's worth noting, anytime, whatever you're billed at wrestling height in WWE, you're probably 3 inches shorter, right. Truthfully.
Correct, but he does look like a big dude.
A big, tall dude, and when he came in pretty hot. He's like, he was an amateur wrestler in college. He won the world championship, and then they gave him the We the People storyline.
Yeah.
Which, We the People was it was about 5 years ago at this point, with... Zeb Coulter, about basically a build-a-wall kind of character.
Yeah.
But it's weird because as much as we all love wrestling here, WWE audiences tend to be fairly, let's say, conservative, maybe politically.
Yeah.
For the most part, the what you would think of as a cliche wrestling fan. So despite the fact that they think they were really trying to make this like anti-immigrant character a heel, he wasn't really getting any major response in arenas.
Right.
Like, some people would cheer, some people would boo. He was,
I think, people
heel.
Really like to say, "We the people," and then that was it.
And then they paired him up with Cesaro,
right?
And that kind of helped. It helped Cesaro, but it didn't really help Swagger. And then they broke off, and then they feuded for like literally like maybe a week or two, and then Swagger got injured and then busted for weed, and then when he came back, they didn't really use him.
Yeah. He's been doing like the pre-shows that they don't show on television pretty much.
So I don't know. I get it. He was featured far less than Ryback was when Ryback left.
Yeah. And to answer someone in the chat, he's not that big of a draw. Actually, you'd be surprised. Anyone who's ex-WWE for an indie company, they are going to see a lot of money and be a draw because you're getting someone who's ex-WWE to be in your indie show.
I mean, a perfect example might be like featured far more when he left, but like someone like Cody Rhodes.
Yeah.
Cody left and he was mid-card or often featured in matches that were like 10-man tag team matches, and he'd be there in his Stardust costume. Cody Rhodes now is one of the hottest indie wrestlers mm-hmm. in the industry, going from here to New Japan to all these other places. His shirt on Pro Wrestling Tees is the hottest selling shirt right now.
Awesome to hear.
So him just leaving WWE to go travel other places has now made him like a really hot commodity.
And his wife is so cute. I'm sorry. I loved when I saw their first match together. I was just like, oh, adorable. She's got a lot of work to do in the ring, but, you know, she's new.
You have any thoughts on Jack Swagger or people leaving?
Jack Swagger. Well, his name sounds like a porn star.
It's true.
I'll never let you hit a Jack Swagger.
I guess by the time I got back into it, which was last WrestleMania, last April, I didn't see a lot of him to begin with. So I didn't know. He didn't really make much of an impression on me.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think there's also a degree, too, of like they brought him, like the brand split happened. He came on to SmackDown. And it felt like he felt like somebody who like was hurt by the scripted writing. Like he did some kind of like Rolling Stone gag where he's like, it's like the Rolling Stone said, Jack is back. Ah, and the fans were like non-responsive.
Yeah.
It was one of those things where you're like, ooh, someone wrote that.
You know, and people like to kind of scoff at story writing in WWE, but it means so much. It really matters as to how wrestlers are perceived. It's not about the skill. It's about building some sort of mental relationship between the wrestler and the audience. And when it's not there, it really hurts the wrestler, and they just get buried and buried and buried and buried because the same people are on every week.
Which is what I hear about, like, Brock Lesnar, right? He can't really speak for himself or, you know...
He's not the best on the mic.
Yeah, so hence they have...
The little video, I can't remember which week it was, where he just kind of kept getting closer and closer into the can 2 weeks ago. Yeah. I was just like, what? This isn't... I know I'm not supposed to laugh right now, and you're supposed to be scary, but this is hilarious. He just, like, kept getting in the camera.
And Paul Heyman's just behind him.
Brock.
So good.
Brock Lesnar.
Lesnar.
Ladies and gentlemen, my client.
But something else interesting has happened with Jack Swagger. Jack Swagger was like, hey, guys, I'm leaving the WWE.
Oh, and it's also funny. He announced it on Chael Sonnen's podcast. This wasn't like, it hit the dirt sheets because Swagger went on air and talked about it.
Yes. Mm. And then immediately after that, he was going to the UK to fight for WAW, which is a promotion owned by Paige's family. Fun fact, if you know who Paige is. Next weekend in England, right? So this was like announced. They're like, yeah, Jack. So he had immediately moved on from the WWE. But then the WWE came out and said, actually, his contract has not been ended yet. And once it is ended, he will have to wait 90 days. He'll still get paid, but he has to wait 90 days before wrestling for any other promotion.
Yeah, they got those non-compete clauses.
Hmm. So it threw a bit of a wrench.
And we're going to talk about Paige probably in a second, too, because that's worthy of some note. Well, we can just do it right now.
Sure.
So TNA, we don't talk about TNA much, but it's worth talking about TNA tonight. Man, TNA had a massive exodus this last week, guys. So some of the names that left TNA, Drew Galloway, Mike Bennett, and Maria Canales have all officially announced that they're not re-signing. But someone who did come in to sign was Alberto Del Rio, who's now Alberto Peltrone, is what he's going by now, who in real life is the fiancé of Paige. And Paige was at that TNA taping where Alberto premiered. So there's rumors abound.
I thought you said the Beyonce for a second, and I was like, well, what is she the Beyonce of?
The Beyonce.
And then I was like, oh, okay, no, never mind.
Was at TNA. But the big thing that happened with TNA this week, beyond all those exits, was we also had the leaving of the Hardy Boys.
Yes.
Matt and Jeff Hardy have left TNA. They did not re-sign, and they've been lately going on these like interesting little tours. What was it called? It was like the Tour of Gold or something along those lines?
It had a weird name. I don't remember actually what it was either.
Where they were going to all the indie championships or Ring of Honor and things of that nature to fight their gold tag champions. And it's been like a fun little tour if you follow them online.
And they just like teleport to the next place. They're like, sense the gold.
Someone's saying they literally just won the ROH titles tonight.
Yes.
Guys, live breaking news.
Did you know that TNA is officially Impact Wrestling now? Officially?
Officially Impact Wrestling.
Nice.
Officially. So and here's the rumor.
Sorry, since I did run away, I don't know if you've announced the other people.
I did. Drew Galloway, okay, Maria. Cool. Yep. But here's the rumor: are the Hardys heading back to WWE?
That is the rumor, and I think that they probably are, and I think it's going to be the worst thing ever.
Well, point one: are they heading back to WWE? Point two: TNA is claiming they own the deleted Matt Hardy character. That if Matt and Jeff go back, they cannot do what they've been doing in TNA, which, as silly as it's been, has truly been the hottest thing in wrestling this last year.
Yeah. It's weird. It's strange. It's confusing for non-wrestling fans when they watch it. They're like, what?
It's so good.
It's like when you give porn silly. Like a story. Like, you're just like, why did you what? So
Have you seen any of this? Have Matt Hardy?
Not this
segment?
One. No.
Oh, my gosh. So basically, for anyone watching, the best way to describe this, it's very intentional, but it feels like It truly just feels like the Hardys were given all this, like not all this money, but enough money to go film like little segments out and about in the woods to build up wrestling storylines. And they just went crazy. Matt Hardy is playing a character called Broken Matt Hardy, who believes he is a 9,000-year-old spirit. His son is the chosen one. And Jeff Hardy is now going by the name Brother Nero, which is his real middle name is Nero. It feels like something, yeah, you would come across, like, it, you could put this on in a triple feature with, like, Piranha 3D.
Yes.
Or I was going to say, it's like the plot, or the plot of an anime, really. It's just...
Oh, it's so crazy, and it's so much fun. I highly recommend checking out any of these different deletion storylines. But the minute their contract was up, Matt Hardy started tweeting at WWE wrestlers.
Yeah.
Including Sasha Banks, Roman Reigns. He says, the Roman Empire must be deleted! Which then made a bunch of people go, oh my god, Broken Matt Hardy's going to come to WWE! And then TNA was like, no, we own that character.
Yeah.
So now there might be some legal things happening between the Hardys and TNA, which would be very sad, if only because... Really, honest, let's just put it on front street. The Hardys kept that company alive for the last year.
Yeah, it's interesting how much the bigger indies are starting to do this really strong lawyer action stuff. You know, like Lucha Underground.
Yes.
You know, the other week we told that story in the last podcast. But they're really starting to come after each other for these names and these characters. And it makes you wonder if it's a good thing to do or if it's just going to drive more wrestlers to choose other options. So... I don't know. I kind of feel like you should probably let the wrestlers build themselves and build their character and do their thing and build their audience. And then you are now bringing that audience to you whenever you have that wrestler on. To me, that just seems to make so much more sense than being like, no, you cannot be on that other thing.
But there's also a degree, too. It's like even if they were able to bring in that those deleted Matt Hardy and Broken Nero characters, Brother Nero characters... Would WWE let them write it?
No, absolutely. Yeah. WWE would ruin that. That's what I was saying. If they do come, it's going to get weird. They couldn't even get simple. I love WWE, but they can't even get simple things right. I definitely don't think they're going to understand the weirdness of this.
Well, yeah, it comes down to reading your contracts. I mean, you're talking about owning a character and all that. If they have to, when they sign off on that, whether they read it or not, their signature means they accept those circumstances. So
yeah. And there's fun little things people do, like Bad News Barrett right now is going around the indie circuit as Fake News Barrett with only one T, so he can still be called Barrett.
Good.
Because WWE owns the double T Barrett name, which is, that's how these things work. Wrestling is very weird, folks.
Isn't Rey Mysterio still wrestling right now?
Yeah, he's in Lucha.
Yeah.
He's in
Underground. So, it's things like that, but he's not Rey Mysterio. So, it seems so petty. In a lot of ways, like you already don't pay wrestlers as much as they deserve for how much they put on the line. And they already don't have like set things like real salaries. And a lot of things are still on handshake agreements. Like the least you could do is let these people carry their names and their audiences with them.
Like, right. Like you build a brand under a certain name, you know. Yeah, he may be Snoop Lion now, but people still think he's Snoop Dogg.
I think he's back to Snoop Dogg.
We went back. Huh? Okay.
I think so. When Prince went back to being Prince.
He did, after the unpronounceable signature.
The signature, yeah.
I like to pronounce
love
it.
Love symbol.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
R.I.P.
I have voices.
If I had them. I need to learn the words of that song besides they talk to me.
I know. So, guys, let us get into some Fastlane predictions. The pay-per-view, it's tomorrow. We'll be watching it. We're going to talk about it next week, but let us get into the matches.
I love voice actors. That was so cool. Those cars sounded really great.
Oh, man. So we got Charlotte versus Bayley. This is Charlotte, right?
Yeah, Charlotte.
It's Charlotte. They're building up the storyline for so long that Charlotte never loses at a pay-per-view. They are not going to have her lose at Fastlane.
Not at Fastlane.
Yeah. Woo! Mm-hmm. She's going to lose. Did you ever see Ric Flair?
Back in the day, yeah, I do remember Ric Flair.
Oh my god, that beautiful hair.
I watched the WrestleMania where he won. Dude looked like he had snorted so much, like a mountain of.
He might have probably.
Back in the day, come on.
Speaking of his hair, Charlotte looked extra hot this week. I do just have to give the hair and makeup the Glam Squad a shout out because they had her hair and her makeup looking amazing. Carry on.
On fleek, as the kids say.
Yes, super fleek.
Charlotte always fabulous. But yeah, it's gonna be Charlotte's gonna win this. I don't think they're gonna go for the dusty finish. For those who don't know, the dusty finish is where you try to make both wrestlers look good by having a kind of a weird ending where no one really wins, but no one really loses. Mm-hmm. I don't think they're gonna do that. I think my prediction for both this and Mania, Charlotte's gonna win this. She'll have the belt back. She's then gonna lose at Mania, and it'll be the big storyline that it's like Charlotte finally lost at a pay-per-view.
Because she's never lost at a pay-per-view. All the hugs in the world won't save Bayley. Is that what we're saying?
No.
You know what was really weird? Watching Charlotte and Sasha have another match really just reminds me how much better Charlotte's matches are with Sasha than with Bayley, which is terrible. Yeah. I love what Bayley does for the kids and for people who need a face, and I love that she's different, but at the same time, like, Sasha and Charlotte had, like, matches every single week, and they were all interesting, exciting, and good, and just seeing her kind of go back to wrestle Charlotte again, I was like, ugh. And I know Bayley can have good matches because Bayley had a good match with Sasha. Yeah.
Well, we're gonna talk about that later down the line. But weirdly, Hulk Hogan and Ric Flair always looked old to me. There's the thing about 80s era wrestler, man. Some of those guys are our ages, like in that time, and they already look like 55 year old men.
True.
So much road damage. You gotta watch out, girl. You gotta watch out.
My face.
Kevin Owens versus Goldberg. This one's hard to predict. Match is the match. There's two sides of this. There's Goldberg wins because Vince wants him to go into Mania as the Universal Champion and face Brock Lesnar. Make Goldberg Lesnar a championship match.
Yeah.
However, there's also a possibility Lesnar comes in and interferes.
I just think it's very confusing to do it that way because that is what most of us think. Most of us think Goldberg is going to win so he can have a belt, so it's a championship match. But that begs the question, does it need to be a championship match?
It does not.
It absolutely does not.
Okay.
So it's taking away the story from somebody else to do that for WrestleMania. So I don't know. I think it's a strange choice if they do it. So I'm not above them swerving us.
Goldberg is still a thing. Yes, Goldberg is still a thing. But actually, he's been pretty great this run. This
because
recent run's been a lot of fun.
Kept it short.
He kept it real short. Yeah. You know what? My prediction, I'm going Goldberg wins. Vince McMahon is a guy who wants that to be the third match. I'm sure he wants it to be a Universal Championship match. I would love it if it was Kevin Owens, because then it would be Owens Jericho for the belt at
Which
Mania.
Which makes so much more sense, storytelling wise.
But I imagine it's going to be Goldberg. But at the same time, here's the thing about McMahon. He might call it on the day.
It's very true. He does that. And you know, it is worrying, though. Goldberg's matches have been incredibly short, as Kevin Owens has pointed out. Well, Kevin Owens is known for going for very long matches.
Yeah.
We've seen him last through a lot of things. So unless Goldberg just utterly destroys him the same way he did Brock Lesnar, like, I have no idea what this match is going to be.
What's the latest on Finn Balor? We're waiting to hear. It sounds like he's going to be at Mania Week, but I don't think he will be participating in the actual Mania. But that'd be cool. Maybe he's a surprise running on a match. That'd
he was another
great
example of a wrestler who came in real hot and then was immediately hurt and kind of had his whole story tanked, similar to Seth. And Seth was the one who hurt him.
True.
That's right.
So I don't know about, I'm going to go Goldberg on that one. Roman Reigns versus Braun Strowman. I think it's Braun.
Totally Braun.
I think it's going to be a schmozzy ending. Schmozzing is when you do a confusing ending, wrestling terms.
Yeah.
Cause they always want to make Roman look strong, but they're building up Braun.
I have the dissenting voice. Yep.
Oh.
I feel that Roman has been getting beat up by Braun over and over again.
Beautifully.
So I think that means in their brains, he is on a come up. So I think he will win this, or it will be like disqualified by other people interfering, because in their mind, he's losing. Okay, he's going to come back and he's going to finally beat this Braun guy is what I think they're going for.
Hooray!
Yeah. Yes.
Hooray. I'm going with Braun, but I hear what you're saying.
We can argue. We can disagree. It's a fun of wrestling.
Samoa Joe versus Sami Zayn.
Sami going to get crushed.
Yeah. Poor Sami Zayn, man. Sami Zayn's so good. And Sami Zayn can be this generation's Daniel Bryan if they just crush him for a while and bring him up. But man, he's getting crushed a lot, like to the point where he's going to start feeling ineffectual.
Yeah.
They're building up some mojo.
It's hard with him. They seem like they keep giving him little fits and starts. But one of the things is there is a place for everyone. There's a certain place for people in wrestling, right? And you do need that person who people love, who can sell really well, to get beat up to make other people look strong. It's part of wrestling. Normally it's the older guys who are being forced to do it. Like, oh, you know, if Roman beats Undertaker, we'll finally love him. It's not true. So I kind of see why they use Sammy this way. He's so easy to love. It doesn't even matter if he keeps getting beat up. You're like, that ska music hits, and you're like, yeah, he's just going to keep going.
With his little Newsies hat.
I had Spider Gwen pants.
Yeah,
That's all I think.
Yep. Neville versus Gallagher. Neville's got to retain. You got to keep it on Neville.
Yeah.
I love Jack Gallagher. I love what he's doing, but Neville's keep hit Heel Neville is keeping that program alive.
I like the umbrella, the whole thing.
Oh, I love that too.
I think Gallagher is great. I think he's got a lot of steam, but I think that steam just started. Mm-hmm. So I think they need to keep building him.
If you make Gallagher, I think Gallagher's better if he's chasing the title.
Yeah.
I think that's where it's got to be right now. I think it's going to go. I think Neville's going to retain. Gallows and Anderson versus Enzo and Cass. God, they hop. Ever since the New Day lost this title, they hot potato this title. Keep it on Gallows and Anderson. Let them go to Mania as champs. Please. Please. Let Enzo and Cass win it at Mania. Let it be a Mania moment.
I don't like anything about this situation.
I don't either.
It's hard to believe that supposedly these monsters are able to be defeated by a buffoon and one really big strong guy. The way they've been telling this story, it's even hard to believe when they beat Cesaro and Sheamus the other week. It was like, okay, whatever. So I don't really think there's a way that Enzo and Cass can win this.
But you never know. It's Vince. Vince McMahon is a finicky man.
I don't know. The crowd has really started to turn on Enzo.
I think because they haven't done much with him outside of his intros.
Right. You can't be a smack talker and constantly lose. No one wants that.
See, the intros are so great, and I love that. And everyone in the is all saying, and you can't, you know.
Well, that's similar. That
song is on my pump-up list when I got to go to the gym.
But that's similar to Jack Swagger, where you have a thing that everyone says, but they don't actually care about you and your story.
Right.
And even Cass has been giving Enzo looks, which suggests to me that they're going to do something to split them up soon.
Ooh.
And kind of boost Cass, because it seemed like they were starting to boost Cass for a little bit. He was in one of the Fatal 4-Way matches or something. I can't remember. You know, guys, once tomorrow passes, I don't remember what happened before. But anyway,
She's been concussed.
I have. It's true. They seemed like they were trying to build Cass for a little bit, and then it kind of got buried under other storylines. So I wouldn't put it past them having something major happen. Enzo finally pushes Cass too far, and Cass splits up from him. But we'll see.
Well, there's also that weird thing, too, is like that weird thing where now we live in this era where faces, people are supposed to be faces, do very heely things. Like in the Enzo Big Cass versus Rusev storyline, Enzo was supposed to be the face, but he's doing things like hitting on Rusev's wife, and he's going to make her cheat on him, and all these like things where you're like, these are heel moves, but Rusev was supposed to be the heel in that storyline.
Right.
It's so strange, and that never helps these characters when it's this gray line for both.
Well, and also in NXT, you didn't see them every single week, if I'm remembering correctly. You know, I think Enzo in smaller doses would be fine. But then there is the other thing of merch. You know,
they're huge.
I'm pretty sure their merch is selling a lot.
I'm sure.
And
certified G shirts are everywhere.
Right. So you can't really get rid of somebody if their merch is doing really well. You kind of have to kill their story first, so the merch sales go down. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I agree with your assessment about who's going to win, but I am very confused about what they're going to be able to do with Enzo and Big Cass.
And final match, Sasha versus Nia Jax. This was a quickie at Royal Rumble. This is a rematch.
Yeah.
Well, Nia's building a beast. Sasha.
Yeah, they're building up Sasha in the Bayley-Charlotte storyline.
Mm-hmm.
So I feel like that would indicate, but you know, I know you never, there's opposite momentum. There's the rule of opposite momentum in WWE. Seth Rollins loses at the beginning of WrestleMania. He wins the championship by the end of the night. So I could see Sasha losing this one and then interfering in the Charlotte Bayley match.
Yeah, I think that's going to be the case because they need Nia to look really strong.
Yes.
It's unfortunate. Nia and Sasha matches don't really do anything for me either. I really enjoyed the Nia and Bayley matches a lot more. So I'm not really sure what's going wrong there because Sasha is small enough for Nia to swing around, which is what she tends to do.
I think Sasha's a natural, she's a much better natural heel. Whereas Bayley is the huggable character, so Nia coming in and like destroying Bayley, you're
right.
Like, no!
I think,
but Nia coming in and destroying Sasha, you're like, okay.
Yeah. I think that's probably true. It's very confusing what Raw is doing with the women. They should maybe call someone at SmackDown and just take a few notes and then go back.
So let me ask you this. Do we feel, because they split up the women's division with the brand split, do we feel maybe the division was too thin to do that at that point?
The fact that they included the injured women in the brand split, I think, was really strange. And I also think, I don't want to say Raw was greedy, because I'm sure there's some sort of business reason for it. But taking all of the quote-unquote powerhouses, like the most popular women, and putting them on one show seems kind of dumb. Because it's harder to tell stories if everyone is somebody you like. And there were, I don't know, there's way fewer of them because people were injured. It just seems like they maybe either should have waited or not sent Alicia Fox down to the cruiserweights. I don't know. It's very
strange. Well, there's
a degree
of like the fact that we're not going to see, at least for a while, Alexa Bliss versus Charlotte is a bummer.
And the fact that no woman can be found to be a manager for Nia, like, okay, we got all these injured women. Pick one of them to come and be the spokesperson for Nia Jax because she should never speak ever.
Yeah, I'm looking at the chat there. It's like, she sounds like she's going to the mall.
That's what I said before. Every time she talks, she's like, I'm going to go to the mall and then I'm going to come back and I'm going to kick your ass, Sasha. It's like, you are not scary.
Yeah, that was a good thing about China. They didn't let China speak much. And when she did, she's like, I'm going to kick your ass. Yeah, China was not someone who's like, I'm going to kill everyone.
Right. I do think it's funny. Like, why do like the strongest, biggest women always seem to have these voices that are like, hey, I've been talking like this. Like, why did China talk like that? Why does Nia talk like that? We can't find some bass, some vocal coaches to get in there and just help you out. Anyway. Oh, man.
So good. So yeah, that's Fastlane, guys. We're gonna dive into it next week. But those are our predictions. Our predictions currently, Charlotte's gonna take it. I think we're thinking Goldberg. Mm-hmm. We're with Braun, you're with Roman.
Right.
We're all thinking Samoa Joe.
Yeah.
Thinking Neville, Gallows and Anderson, and Nia.
Yeah.
So that's where we are. So guys, I'm gonna probably be live tweeting tomorrow, so definitely follow me on Twitter. I'm probably gonna be tweeting about that. Once it's happening,
I'll be live tweeting from Women Wrestling F.
There it is, and we'll see. We'll see also because sometimes they do like pre-show matches that they announce on the day. Mm-hmm. So if you didn't hear it there, it's possible like on the day they'll suddenly be like, "Oh, let's have a Shooting Stars versus these guys match." That happens quite often.
Now we're going to take Q&A because we always wait too long to take Q&A.
Well, do you want to assign homework real quick and then we'll do Q&A?
Your homework is to watch Bayley versus Sasha, the NXT TakeOver match from Brooklyn, August 22nd, 2015. You can find it if you search Bayley versus Sasha. That's your homework. And come with your Undertaker homework as well.
So, yeah, Undertaker Shawn Michaels, buried alive, casket match. And yeah, Bayley Sasha. Brooklyn TakeOver. Those are your two homework assignments. We're going to talk about those next week along with Fastlane. But yeah, guys, Q&A time. Throw us some questions. Let us know. They can be super deep wrestling questions or they can be super simple and silly and fun fantasy questions.
I feel bad that you guys always ask so many questions and we're hardly ever able to get to them. So now is your chance.
We're gonna have to have like a question special.
Yeah, there was even when I did Honesty Hour, there were so many wrestling questions that Zach was like, I'm not going to sit here and ask Sarah a bunch of wrestling questions since I don't like wrestling. So I didn't get to answer any of them. And you guys can always use the hashtag ready to ramble to ask us questions.
R2R.
Later.
Yeah. Which I've been using.
Oh, yeah? Maybe R2R. That's why I haven't seen you tweeting R2R. Anything.
R2R. Best recipe for a slow cooker pork butt. Oh, man.
Really depends on if you like sauerkraut or not.
What's your favorite wrestling impression to do? I love doing Macho Man.
I love doing Paul Heyman.
Paul Heyman's also fun.
Brock Lesnar!
What about you?
I worked Macho Man into my Ox King on Dragon Ball Z.
Chi-Chi's getting married. Snap into a Slim Jim.
You know, it's just like a very special
Elizabeth.
Macho Man setting.
Elizabeth!
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
That was amazing. Do you have a good game to watch for someone who's never watched wrestling before? A good game?
Where's that one?
Like a good match.
It's a top one. Do you mean a good match?
Well, that WrestleMania 2.
Yeah.
Man. Whew. That's good stuff.
Well, we signed like, and that's the kind of the things for the homeworks. The homeworks are trying to be, for those of you who are viewers who are not wrestling people, to go grab those matches. Because, I mean, we could throw you the big bloody or the big complicated matches. But we try and show you the matches where it's like, here's why wrestling can
right.
be awesome.
This is like very simple storylines, the kind of thing you can immediately understand why people see the superheroes in wrestling. Someone said, do we miss intergender matches? And I'm going to say absolutely.
Oh, that's a controversial statement.
It is. So part of the reason why they went away was because of domestic violence, things like that. But to be fair, at that time in the Attitude Era, they also had all these other terrible things they were saying and doing so that it created that. For example, my friend sent me the other day the match with China and the two old guys whose names I can't remember right now.
Patterson and Briscoe.
Yes. And if you watch that match with the sound off, entertaining, there's some risque parts, whatever. But if you listen to the commentary during it, you want to reach through and slap the king in his stupid fat mouth. Yes, because there were all these other things. So if right now we did intergender matches the same way they're going on in Lucha Underground, the same way they're going on in independent circuits all over the world, I think it would be amazing. I think it would be fun. Because, I mean, right now they've got ridiculous things like women valets just standing in front of their guy so that the other wrestler can't get their guy. And there's no fear. You
Maurice is currently doing?
Right. You never have to be afraid that Maurice is about to get sent through a table. And I don't like that. I want to be afraid when a big guy stands up to her that she could possibly get hurt too.
Going against good old JR and what he thinks.
I know. I don't care.
We got Crawford Corsair Crown Sandwich. If we could trade one NJPW wrestler and a WWE wrestler, who would it be? Kenny Omega.
Give us Kenny Omega
and WWE. Who would we send over there to make it interesting? Now, it's not about getting rid of someone bad, because if we're taking someone good, I want to send someone good over there. You know what? Sammy. I want to see what Sammy can do with some of those New Japan guys.
Sammy would just fill in the hole of Kenny Omega and become the new Kenny Omega in a way.
Make him the new king of the Bullet Club?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
There was another question, sorry, if we hate the brand split and we wish that there was more crossover.
I like it. To me, that's how you get AJ Styles to be champion for so long. Because AJ is great, but they wanted Roman to be champ. So they make, the brand split allows people who would not, and that was the thing about the earlier brand split too, back in the early days, in the early 2000s. Brand split allowed people like a CM Punk to become the champ for the first time. And Edge, who was not champion at that point, and to prove to McMahon and the other rest of the people in the company, I can be a champion and I can hold this belt.
I agree, but I do wish there were more inter-brand matches.
I agree with that.
And I wish that they had more opportunity, like that they weren't so focused on the titles, because I think that's what prevents it. Like, oh, well, there's no point in having the women fight with somebody from the other brand because they can't win the championships.
Titles is too focus heavy this time. Yeah, I agree with that.
Okay.
Fantasy wrestling stable.
Oh. Ooh,
that might be a thinker. We might need to come back to that.
Yeah,
one.
Somebody that tweet one. That to us so we can think about it and answer it, because I do like that question a lot, but I want to think about it.
Well, guys, we have time for one more. I'm going to have to wrap this bad boy up.
Dun, dun, dun.
Yeah, right. Thanks for making me catch up with Total Divas last Sunday. Hey, you know what?
You
are
welcome.
Because when it comes back, we're gonna start writing some sketches.
It's so crazy.
Fantasy match in the future. Oh man, I want Cesaro to have the belt.
I want him to be Samoa Joe and AJ Styles.
That's very good. I want Cesaro with the belt defending. Oh, Kenny Omega.
Yeah.
Cesaro with the belt defending against Kenny Omega.
Cesaro, he's so good.
So good.
I just.
The things he does every, I feel like every year he puts some new stuff in his arsenal and it's like this guy
you know,
just gets better and
randomly,
better.
Randomly, I just want to give a shout out to the Shining Stars. Their match with the Big Show, pretty quick, but like they are such professionals and so good at what they do. Like when Big Show is reaching down and pulling them on, you know, pulling him onto the apron and then pulling him into the ring, that's actually, I can't remember whether it was Epico or Primo at that time. I think it was Primo. That was actually Primo jumping, you know, like Big Show wasn't actually pulling him by his head. Just like little things that you wouldn't know unless you know kind of more the back end stuff of wrestling. Like there's a reason why they can kind of use them to build other people up. It's because they're so good at their job. So shout out to the Shining Stars for making the Big Show look so strong.
Someone asked you, what's your favorite wrestling entrance? We did that last week.
Oh, okay.
Entrance
Seth
theme.
Rollins. I'm a metal guy, so I just love that.
So good.
Yeah. Love it. Love it. Love it.
That's a great one.
Oh, we should ask you guys what you thought about Luke Harper, but we're out of time. So I'm Sarah the Rebel. You can find me as Sarah the Rebel everywhere. I also have a wrestling podcast that has been stalled momentarily, but go catch up. It's called Women Wrestling F, Women Wrestling Friends. Also, it cost me a lot of money to get here every day. So if you liked me on Honesty Hour and you liked me on Gauntlet, please become a patron. Go to patreon.com/SarahTheRebel and pay for my rides here.
As for me, you can find me on twitter.com/JurassicAlien. And you can find me here on Mondays. Doing Indomitable with Hector Navarro.
You don't even know that man's name.
It just went out of my mind. Scott Porter and Erica Limbeck. And we play HeroClix. And it's a blast. Tune in on my Twitter. I'm going to be talking about Fastlane. I'll talk about all kinds of craziness.
And thank you so much, Kyle, for being on the show. That was awesome. You're our first guest, and you actually came up with the name Ready to Ramble.
Yep.
Right.
Winner.
It came to me in a dream. No, I was watching the show. And it's like, untitled wrestling show, you guys went on the air without a title. It's like, okay, that's cool.
YOLO.
It's the power to the people and all that stuff. I'm at Kyle Hebert on Twitter. Yeah, I usually talk about pop culture stuff and do a lot of resharing of memes and stuff. And I'll probably be live tweeting the Fastlane stuff too on the big wrestling pay-per-views. And of course, you can hear my voice occasionally on Dragon Ball Super as the voice of Gohan and other things on Toonami on Saturday nights.
Cool.
We're definitely going to have you back.
Thank you, man.
Because we're going to do some deep dive. Do you have your own personal homework assignment you would think people should go watch?
Oh, my God. I think just digging up the Von Erichs just to give some old school some love. Just any classic. I mean, not Fritz from the 60s, unless you really, really want to go back to that. We're talking Cary Von Erich back in the day when he was, but he was Cary Von Erich and before he had a different name.
Oh, yeah.
I think so.
That's right. So, guys, go check those out, and we will be back here next week with fast lane results, two homework assignments, maybe iffy.
we don't know.
Unless, like, Sarah puts them through a table.
I'll call it for you.
On Monday. It'll be great. Guys, stick around. We got chunky salsa. We got food being made. Cutting out. This is Ready to Ramble.
Oh, yeah.
Brother.
Hey, guys.